Live from our 7 Tasmania studios, your nightly news with Joe Palmer begins now.
Good evening, everyone. A blaze has torn through a cafe after hot towels left in a dryer caught fire. Authorities are now warning of the dangers of taking shortcuts when using electrical appliances. And it was a day of high stress for firefighters also called to a burning boat at Denali.
It's an appliance many households use every day. But these worrying images reveal the aftermath of an ordinary dryer used incorrectly. The roof and parts of the kitchen at La Peniza suffering damage due to hot towels catching alight.
It was caused through a dryer being turned off prior to it going through its cool down cycle.
Four fire crews arrived at the scene at around 3:30 this morning and managed to stop the blaze from spreading to the front of the building, the incident prompting a reminder from fire authorities.
If you're going to stop a dryer mid-cycle, you need to remove all the clothing or items from the dryer. Otherwise, let it run through its full cool-down process first.
Later this morning, crews responded to a fire in the hull of this boat here in Dunalley. The owner was on board at the time and managed to escape after attempting to put out the blaze himself.
Because he was doing the fire suppression activities, he actually has sustained some smoke inhalation. The local ambulance service attended to him on scene.
The small blaze sparked by a battery.
The power from the batteries, because the degreaser has been atomised, it's been enough to spark the degreaser and then caught the atomised degreaser alight.
Ruby Kamane, 7 Tasmania News.
A 16-year-old boy has been charged with attempted armed robbery of a McDonald's restaurant in Invermay on Monday night. CCTV footage emerged yesterday of a person entering the premises armed with a knife. It's alleged he demanded cash from staff, but a quick-thinking customer intervened and hit him with a plastic chair. The teenager faced the Launceston Youth Justice Court this morning. A man has died following a car crash on Saturday. The two-car collision occurred at Main Road at Wivenhoe, with the 60-year-old suffering minor injuries. The man from Penguin was taken to Northwest Regional Hospital as a precaution, but his condition deteriorated. The driver of the other car was not injured. A report will be prepared for the coroner. A Launceston jury has heard how an accused murderer told others he'd killed a snake on the same day he allegedly mowed down a man in Prospect Vale. But police witnesses today recounted how Joshua Joseph Barker was unaware over who it was he'd actually killed.
On the day he allegedly struck down Dale James Watson, Joshua Barker also paid a visit to the parents of an old high school friend. Today, jurors heard the accused saw Sharon and Dale Burney, who were grieving the loss of a son. Sharon Burney said Mr. Barker initially comforted her, but then claimed he'd killed the snake and kicked the hornet's nest. He quoted Jehovah, which I didn't understand. He then suggested swapping cars with the Burney family. Constable Philip Smith said officers found Mr. Barker asleep on a couch when they arrested him in Trevallon. I explained to him that he'd hit someone in Prospect with his car. He then said, was it Woodson or McDonald? Prosecutors say Mr. Barker and his alleged victim did not know each other. Delivery driver Timothy Bumford described being attacked by a man fitting the defendant's description on the day. The driver was outside Sacred Heart Primary School when the man asked him for a number before he began punching him and searching the van for Christmas presents. Joshua Barker spent much of the day's proceedings with his head lowered and his eyes seemingly closed. He showed little physical reaction as each witness gave evidence. The trial continues tomorrow. Sean McComish, 7 Tasmania News.
After years of preparation, doubts have been raised about the need for a new Bridgewater Bridge. Council saying the money would be better spent elsewhere. While some experts agree the project is overkill, the government remains committed to the $500 million upgrade.
Its replacement has been talked about for decades, a new Bridgewater Bridge promised by 2024. But after years of planning, Greater Hobart councils have joined forces, calling for a cheaper option, saying the money for the $576 million project would be better spent on traffic solutions elsewhere. Councils didn't comment further today, but experts share similar concerns.
So I think the Bridgewater Bridge is overkill, really. Too much money for that fairly small road link.
The upgrade will include two lanes in each direction and a 110 km/h speed limit. But the key advisory body, Infrastructure Australia, says the project's cost outweighs its benefits.
It's not money well spent. It would be better spent on things that do have a high benefit to cost ratio, like fixing up the traffic.
Despite the concerns from both councils and the independent body, the government will push ahead with the plan.
We made commitments to the Tasmanian people, as did the Australian government. The Bridgewater Bridge is fully funded and it's an essential link between the state's most important highway and the capital city.
After 6 years of all talk and press conferences, Infrastructure Australia has sent the government back to the drawing board and we're no closer to the Bridgewater Bridge. So it's pretty understandable that the southern mayors are questioning the project.
Construction of the bridge is expected to begin in 2022. Michelle Wisby, 7 Tasmania News.
Changes to Australia Day celebrations could be on the horizon for one Tasmanian council. Launceston aldermen will tomorrow vote on moving annual citizenship ceremonies to a different day, but the federal government has already warned against the idea.
January 26th, Australia Day. The national holiday celebrating our country, but a day that upsets our Aboriginal communities.
It's one thing to acknowledge a fact, it's another thing to celebrate the destruction of Aboriginal society by the British. And so it's high time we moved away from that and started realising that there are some things you celebrate and there are some things you don't.
In response, traditional Australia Day activities like citizenship ceremonies could be moved to the day before in Launceston. The council to consider the change at a meeting tomorrow.
What it does show is they're trying to be more inclusive. Instead of celebrating the events for one group in society and excluding another, they're now saying, look, let's all find a day that's more suitable.
This is not an act of unification. This is an act of division if it were to take place, because 75% of our fellow Australians actively support Australia Day on the 26th of January.
The federal government has warned against any moves, with a proposal to strip them of the power to hold citizenship ceremonies altogether.
Suffice to say, the government is absolutely committed to the 26th of January being celebrated as Australia Day, when we celebrate modern Australia.
A vote at the Local Government Association in March said that changing the date is a matter for individual councils, depending on their community's opinion.
They need to take the next step and change the way it's been done in the last 20 or 30 years and show leadership and show inclusiveness.
Launceston City Council wouldn't comment on camera. Ebony Ablett, 7 Tasmania News.
A plan to create jobs and attract investment on the northwest coast has launched. The Cradle Coast Prospectus is aiming to draw in more businesses and entice more workers to the region.
The northwest is hoping for an investment boom. The state government today spruiking more jobs and business opportunities across the region, releasing the Cradle Coast Prospectus, detailing opportunities for a range of sectors, mainly around manufacturing, agribusiness and tourism.
We have experienced significant growth in tourism, but that's disproportionate to the rest of the state. There's still a lot more work that can be done.
The prospectus promotes the region's livability, high rates of employee retention and proximity to major mainland cities, while highlighting government incentives such as payroll and tax exemptions.
I think what we'd really like to see is people from outside of the region, the mainland overseas, investing into our region.
We want to see more opportunities taken hold of. We want to encourage and foster all of these competitive advantages that are listed in the prospectus.
The prospectus is part of a wider push across Tasmania to increase investment, with similar plans being put into action across the south. Elizabeth O'Neill, 7 Tasmania News.
Shots have been fired ahead of the highly anticipated TCLW Grand Final between Clarence and Launceston this Saturday, with the Roos confident they can exploit their opponents' weaknesses despite the Blues heading into the decider undefeated. Not pulling any punches ahead of the biggest game of the year.
I think that we're definitely better on the ground than Launceston are, and they've got a few, you know, big players which can be a bit selfish at times, so I think that that's where we'll get them to fall apart.
I think that's an unfair comment. You need players to be taking ownership of what they can do well, and if that's being selfish, then we're more than happy for players to be selfish if it means we're going to win.
Off the back of a 3-goal win over fierce rivals the Pies, Clarence head into the decider as the only side that have properly challenged the undefeated Blues this year.
Yeah, they definitely can be beaten. I mean, we came close. We got within 13 points in round 8, so we're up there. And if we play like we did on the weekend, we're definitely within a chance. All the pressure's on them. We didn't even expect to make the grand final at the start of this season, so we're stoked at where we've come, but we want to finish it off.
While Launceston will be relishing the favouritism tag as the club looks to make it a perfect 2019.
Since day dot, teams have been worried about us and what we're going to do, and rather than, you know, focusing on what they need to do to beat us. So, you know, by all means, we're happy to have that attention. We've been working hard since November to make sure come this time of the year that, you know, a game like this doesn't slip through our fingers.
We've got nothing to lose, so we may as well go in guns blazing.
The opening bounce is at 12:30 p.m. at Blunston Arena. And the buzz is building ahead of the NBL Blitz, with the Illawarra Hawks, including star signing LaMelo Ball, arriving in Hobart today. The 4-day tournament begins tomorrow night with a clash in Ulverston between the Brisbane Bullets and the NBL 1 All-Stars side, followed by a match between the Cairns Taipans and Adelaide 36ers. While Ball will get the chance to show fans what all the fuss is about when the Hawks take on the Perth Wildcats at the Kingborough Sports Centre on Friday night. The Hobart Zebras and Clarence Football Clubs are officially set to join forces, with representatives from both clubs voting in favour of a merger at a meeting in Hobart overnight. The move, designed to create a more viable and sustainable club, will make the NPL an 8-side competition from 2020, made up of 5 Southern, 2 Northern and 1 North West based team.
Good evening. Lake Leake provided us with the low of -6, just pipping Lyweenie last night, but generally a fine day today, plenty of sunshine around. Hobart 18, Launceston 16, Burnie 12 and Devonport 13 degrees. Maximum today was that 18, also recorded by Campania, Ooze and Friendly Beaches. Grove 17 today, St Helens 16, the Bass Strait Islands 15, Strawn and Smithton 14 and Lowhead 13 degrees. Some low-level cloud did stream across the north and southwest of the state, but no rainfall in that patchy cloud. There. Low cloud is also evident over the southwest of Western Australia, patchy cloud over South Australia, a cloud band with thunderstorms still over the New South Wales coast, and approaching cold front moving into the picture in the west as well. Tomorrow, the high remains over the Tasman Sea, blocking the oncoming front and trough. Weak troughs linger over the mainland. Winds north to northeast at 10 to 20 knots, increasing to 20 to 30 knots over the east and west, swells to 4 metres in southern waters. Strong wind warning in the east from and including Flinders Island to southeast Cape, and also for waters between Low Rocky Point and Stanley. 18 today in Hobart, warming up to 22 tomorrow, fine and sunny. Cygnet 21 after a cold night, and 22 the top for New Norfolk. For Launceston, early fog, a clear day later, 20 the high, 16 for Devonport, partly cloudy, mostly sunny for Campbelltown, and 19 degrees. 15 the high for Burnie, bit of cloud about, sunny for Strawn, and 22, excellent, 17 for Smithton, and for St Helens, 18 degrees, the top, maybe a shower, mostly sunny though, a bit further south at Swansea, 21 the top there, and 19 for Fingal. On Friday, mainly fine until a shower develops over the west in the evening. Showers on Saturday, clearing the east later, snow possible to 600 metres. And on Sunday, showers over the west and south, extending statewide for a period in the afternoon. Showers easing from Perth, dry and dusty for Adelaide. Sunny in Melbourne, showers again for Sydney and 21 degrees. Cloudy up the Queensland coast and sunny over the top end. Clear at the moment, 11 degrees in Hobart, 10 degrees in Launceston, mostly clear in Devonport, and 10 degrees as well. A little windy tomorrow, Joe, but okay. The weekend, not so.
All right. Thank you very much. Where's that spring weather? All right. That's all from the team for now. Thanks so much for your company. We'll see you a bit later. Bye for now.